Curator of History of Science Collections here, and so glad that you've come for this episode in Beyond Our Walls. We're thrilled to have Dr. Tania Munz from Linda Hall Library here to talk about the challenges and opportunities as they see them facing their library. Linda Hall Library in Kansas City, Missouri, if you haven't been there, the next time you're traveling through, make time to stop. It's a stunning, beautiful library with tremendous exhibits. But beyond the exhibits, it is the world's foremost independent library for science, engineering, and technology. They receive journals through the 20th century that the Library of Congress did not receive. And that means that they are also, by default, one of the foremost world institutions for the history of science, technology and engineering in the 20th century. But then it goes much deeper than that. They are our aspirational peer in the history of science collections for the history of science in all periods. Dr. Munz is also what's the degrees of separation that Francis Bacon gave? We have a partnership between our library and the Max Planck Institute for the History of Science in Berlin. Dr. Munz did a postdoctoral fellowship for 3 years there in Berlin. After that, she was a postdoctoral fellow at Northwestern. Those experiences will give her great insight into crafting research fellowships at Linda Hall, something I'm very much looking forward to hearing more about this morning, because Dr. Munz is the Vice President for Research, and that includes fellowships and other aspects that come under that umbrella at Linda Hall. You obtained your PhD in History of Science from Princeton University, and Dr. Munz has spent yesterday interacting with faculty and students in the biology program regarding her historical study that just came out on dancing bees, Carl von Frisch and the discovery of the honeybee language that came out late last year, as I recall. And a colloquium on that topic will be presented this afternoon at 3:30 in the History of Science Department meeting room. That's in the Physical Sciences Building, room 402. So if you want to hear about her historical scholarship on dancing bees, that's the program. Here, we're thrilled that she was willing to add to our itinerary the opportunity to lift the veil and give us an understanding of how they're thinking about librarianship at Linda Hall, our peer institution just up I-35 ways. Her visit is sponsored by the University Libraries and by the Department of Biology and the Department of the History of Science, Technology, and Medicine. So, Tania, welcome. We're so glad for you to be with us today.
Thank you. Can everybody hear me? Am I amplified? Okay, great. Thank you so much. Thank you, Carrie, for that introduction and for the invitation, and thanks for the other sponsoring departments for bringing me here. It's lovely to be here. I was here just a year ago when your beautiful exhibits opened, and we saw some of the gorgeous rare books that you have here. I was here for the Midwest Junto Conference, which is a history science conference where a lot of young scholars and graduate students get to present their work. So it's nice to be back. And it's a pleasure to get to talk a little bit about the Linda Hall Library and what we do there. I'm wondering how many people, or if anybody has been to the Linda Hall Library. Has anyone been? I know Carrie has been. Has anyone else been? Okay, enjoy it. So the Linda Hall Library is in Kansas City. It's an independent research library, as Carrie said. To give you a little bit of background, the library was founded in 1946, and it was through the wealth, or through the will of a wealthy Kansas City couple who gave money, who gave their wealth for a library. After they passed away, there was a board that thought about, you know, what kind of library do we want to have here in Kansas City? And they kicked around different ideas, and they decided that Kansas City needed a science, technology, and engineering library to do the most for the city. And over the years, engineering firms and science and technology companies actually came to Kansas City to be close to the Linda Hall Library. So in 1946, the library purchased the entire collections of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. That library had strong periodical holdings. It had exchange partnerships with other learned societies in other countries. And it also had kind of a core, a smattering of rare books. Over the years, the library has continued to purchase in its contemporary collections, thinking mostly about scientists and engineers, and has also made some other major acquisitions. Notably, the acquisition that I really think kind of changed the landscape for the library was in the mid-90s, the Linda Hall Library purchased the entire, or received the entire library of the engineering societies in New York. So to give you an idea, apparently this material came in 18 18-wheelers. So that's the quantity of stuff. So in addition to those kinds of sort of major acquisitions, the library continues to subscribe to journals, continues to purchase books, rare books, contemporary books, monographs, to support research. It's especially strong, as Carrie said, in engineering, the physical sciences, infrastructure, also strong in life sciences. Now what we might group as environmental studies. We have over 200,000 industrial standards. So oftentimes the societies and the agencies that issued standards would tell people to dispose of their superseded standards because they wanted people to have the most current standards. And many of them did, and the Linda Hall Library never did. So we have those older standards, and sometimes the organizations that issue standards will refer people to us because they don't have the old standards anymore. So it has some strengths that have supported researchers over the years. But of course, the information landscape has changed a lot, right? And I think libraries, no matter what kind of a library, no matter what the audience is for the library, libraries really have to grapple with how things have changed, especially in the last couple of decades or so. So what I wanted to talk to you about today is some of the ways in which the Linda Hall Library has responded to those changes as an independent research library. But before I start, I wanted to give you a little bit more background on what my role is, because I'm very much speaking from my perspective at the library, and I should say I've been there for a little over a year only, so I've been there for about 15 months. So I'm still learning and I'm still getting to know the collections and getting to know the different aspects of the library. As Carrie mentioned, my background is in history of science. I got my PhD in 2007, and I did a lot of archival research, and of course I use the library, and I sort of considered myself kind of a super user of libraries, which historians tend to think of themselves, but of course that's very different than being at the other end, right? Being a user of a library, it's almost like the better the work has been done in the background, the less aware the user is of the fact that so much work has been done to make that good user experience. So it's been very interesting for me to learn about how we deal, you know, technical services, how we deal with our collections, preservation, all these kinds of things that I think as a user you get to be blissfully unaware of when things are well done. So with this background in history science, the question that you might ask is, what am I doing at this library, right? Why do these people need a historian of science? It's lucky for me that they felt they did, but it's not really an obvious question. And I should say, in my current role, I oversee the collections, and there's people who are more directly responsible for the collections, but I oversee collections, public services, and the fellowships program. So as I talk about, I'm going to highlight three areas of change and responses to change that the library has made, and I'll talk a little bit about why I'm even there, why this fits into the Linda Hall Library strategy for making changes that address the larger kind of informational landscape changes. And if you have any questions, let me know, and I'm also allowing lots of time at the end so we can talk about it. So one thing that the library decided to do is the library has decided to remain a print repository. The library and its mission is a print repository that documents the science, technology, and engineering disciplines. It serves to raise public understanding of science, and it wishes to serve as an international destination for scholarly research. That's basically the mission statement. In its commitment to be a print repository, the library made a strategic decision to focus on paper. So we have over 48,000 journal titles, some active, some not active, but we have really a massive serial collection. In our current subscriptions, when a journal goes e-only, we will actually cancel it. So we, for various reasons, and I'm sure you can relate to it, including and mainly because of prices, how journal prices have moved and continue to rise, and also for reasons of ownership, we have decided to be print only. Now, there's some positives to that, and there's some drawbacks, right? Positives are that we own the physical material that we have. We've also tried to get the word out that we have room in our stacks, and we will take care of holdings as universities often downsize their own print holdings. We will take them in if they are in scope and in good condition. So we've actually, as university libraries, are making space for collaborative spaces and having other kinds of infrastructure changes that necessitate that they get rid of some of their print holdings, we've been able to get really beautiful stuff and we've been able to take it in. On the other hand, it is, in a way, as a publisher decides to go e-only with a journal, somebody else is making that decision for us to discontinue that subscription, right? I mean, we've decided not to do e-only, but in terms of content, collection, policy, it is, other people are making certain kinds of decisions, right? That we're not actively, we've made an active decision about format, but in terms of content, we have another voice that figures into this. The other response to change that the library has made, and this, Lisa Brower, who's the Linda Hall Library president, was critical in negotiating an agreement with the Center for Research Libraries. Now, I saw Oklahoma is a member of CRL. Bernie Riley, who is the head of the CRL, part of what his vision has been to manage this changing infrastructure or information landscape, he really thinks about how to collectively navigate the challenges that this poses to libraries. And I think as the information landscape is changing and preservation and access are no longer linked, right? It's no longer the case that in order to give access, you need to have thousands of copies of something, and if 100 of them burn down, you still have many copies because preservation and access have been linked. Now, if there's a digital version available, other libraries might think that they can get rid of their paper. Now, I think you all know that having digital versions of things is not a simple matter, right? Maintaining them, taking care of them, making sure they transfer through different system changes, it's never simple. And it still is important to keep paper copies of things. So what the Center for Research Libraries has done is they've decided to consolidate that effort. And they have partnered with different libraries where combined the collections are stronger than if any library is doing it alone, and have designated certain libraries to be the print repositories. So the Linda Hall Library is its science and technology partner. Together, we have over 50,000 journal titles in science, technology, and engineering. So the way the agreement works is we have promised to the Center for Research Libraries that we will hang on to certain paper copies of journals. Together, we have decided to digitize a subset of those journals. So journals where we don't have copyright issues, where the thought is that JSTOR is not likely to digitize them anytime soon, and where we think they're of high and special research value, those collections, like we have some railroad journals that have been digitized, some aeronautics journals, some railroad journals, those journals collectively have been made available digitally to members of CRL. We also provide ILL e-versions of certain journals through RAPID to CRL's member libraries, and CRL pays us a fee for digitizing and for these services. CRL also, as we've decided on what to digitize, CRL has sent those physical journals to us. We're doing the digitizing, and we get to keep those journals because we are the print repository and we said we would take care of them. So I think this is a very interesting way of collectively managing some of the challenges that libraries are facing. And I feel like this is, you know, we get to be part of something that makes a lot of sense and is really kind of visionary. And they're doing it with other libraries as well. So that's one example that I wanted to mention. Now, my final example, and that gets to the question of what am I doing at this library? Why am I there? Is a strategic decision by the library in terms of the direction that it's taking. As you can imagine, scientists and engineers and technology professionals, there is not as much of a need anymore to go into a brick and mortar institution, right? Most of what they need, practicing scientists and engineers, they will use online and they don't actually need to come to the Linda Hall Library. Now, for many, many years, Doc Dell was a big part of what the Linda Hall Library did, but that traffic has gone down as well. So as the library was thinking about who should be our audience, as Carrie said, it's a beautiful building, it's a lovely space, and I think, you know, as the leadership of the library thought about how do we continue to make this space relevant, we have these amazing print holdings. One of the ideas, or the vision that they came up with, was to move the institution in more of a history of science direction. So we have, you know, our serial holdings, we have continuous print runs, some print runs going back to the 17th century that are still active subscriptions today. Who wants to use those materials in paper? And who are we preserving this material for? And the value of preserving it, how do we get that value? We get it by having people use it. So the people who want to use paper and who want to use those sources, historians of science and technology are a really good audience for that. So that is why when my job was created, the idea was to bring the collections and the public services and the scholarship piece under kind of a history science umbrella. And that was the thinking. As we rethink our collections policy and we make minor tweaks with it, we now do it trying to think and trying to anticipate what scholars in science and technology studies and history, sociology, anthropology of science, what they might be interested in using. So in my current role, a lot of what I was thinking about when I came into the position was how do we get people to come to the library? We had a fellowships program, it was started in 2012, so it was pretty young, and we were not getting the kinds of application numbers that we thought the collections deserved. Like, we were just not as well known as we thought we should be based on the collections. I think our rare books collection, we have about 10,000 volumes that we keep in a climate-controlled vault, and then we have about another 10,000 that are kind of medium rare in a cage. So we have this history science collection that I think historians of science did know about, especially who worked in the early modern period. But we had all these amazing technology and engineering sources as well, and we had those as well. And we had, you know, really good serial holdings in things like environmental studies, in climate, in biology, in physics, in engineering, more contemporary engineering disciplines. We really started to think about how do we get the word out about our history of science collections that document the history, science, and technology from the 15th century to the present, actively collecting. So I looked at our fellowships program, the person who managed the fellowships program before me did a very nice job of kind of building and setting up a fellowships program that would capture our fellows' experiences. So we had really good documentation on how, what people liked, what they didn't like, what they felt they wanted. One of the things that came through very clearly is that they thought the collections were superb, they were very happy with how they had been treated by the staff, but that their experience sort of was dependent on whether or not they felt they had intellectual community, right? As historians, we tend to spend a lot of time kind of by ourselves in archives or reading books, but at the end of the day or during lunch, people really want to talk about their work and exchange ideas. So one of the things I've been doing this past year is to really try to build intellectual community at the library by networking with University of Missouri, Kansas City, KU. KU Med is a beautiful history of medicine collection. So different scholars in the area and bringing them to the library to workshop their works in progress and having them think of bringing their classes there, right? So I think one thing that's different about an independent research library from a university library is that we really don't have to support a curriculum like a university does, right? A university thinks about what do our professors need, what do our students need. For better and worse, we don't really have to think about that, right? And I think there really are kind of pros and cons to that. But building intellectual community is really important for getting people, when they come, to feel like this is an active place, a lively place where stuff happens. The other thing we did was we restructured our fellowships program. So part of the thinking was, if we offer people an opportunity to come visit, we think that they will come back. And what's even better is we think that they will tell other people about it. So we created a travel fellowship. I mean, this is a very simple kind of tweak, right? Where people can come from 1 to 3 weeks. If they have a break, like spring break, or if they want to come at the beginning or the end of their summer, or there's some kind of a gap where they can come, we will help defray the cost of their travel and lodging and all that to come work in our collections. And then the other thing we did for our fellowships program, I'm very excited about this, is we, as we were having conversations, we talked to folks who have a lot of grad students. We sort of felt like grad students are a very good audience for us because we're a young fellowships program. Our collections are so, we think, so spectacular that they can help shape people's dissertation topics. And if we get somebody kind of on the ground when they're starting out, we can grow up with them. We will be part of their dissertations. We can be part of their books. We are going to be, they're going to talk about us to their students, future public intellectuals. It seemed like it was a good place for us to offer really good service and a really good experience is for young scholars who are just starting out. The other thing, I have been on the Council for the History Science Society, and as you know, the education of PhDs for a while, but I think people are really talking about it at the moment, the job market is not great. And my interest had been in the History Science Society, the society has been very supportive, is to help graduate students think about developing a broad skill set and making it that the academy can feel a little bit more permeable, right? So people who got PhDs in history of science, who have gone on to do other things, that the society can keep in touch with them, that the grad students can have contact with them. And the History of Science Society is not the only society, right? The AHA has been very good about raising awareness of the fact that graduate students in the humanities need a broad skill set. It is not enough for graduate students to become excellent scholars, although that is, of course, the bread and butter. But they will also be better academics if they have a broader skill set. And I know that you're doing, I was hearing this morning a little bit about the kind of digital humanities training that your graduate students get precisely to address this need. So we created a new fellowship called the 80-20 Fellowship. The fellow, this is for a pre-doctoral fellow, comes for a full academic year for 10 months and spends 80% of his or her time doing research in our collections and 20% of their time curating an exhibition based on their research and based on our library's holdings. And we were very deliberate that we wanted to address the types of skills that the AHA had identified for wanting, or skills that they felt humanity scholars should have. So things like being able to work in teams. I mean, it's kind of the simple common sense stuff, right? Quantitative literacy, we interpreted that we want that person to manage their own budget. Being able to speak confidently and publicly about their research and why it matters. So we're going to work with that graduate student to help, that person is going to report to the VP for public programs. And we're going to work with that student to get some media training and to really get a platform for showcasing the beautiful work that they are doing. So those are some of the ways. We also did a sort of full-on marketing campaign by talking to lots of folks in the field. We wanted to tell them about our collections. We wanted to hear what they thought, where they thought the field was headed. We wanted to tell them about our fellowships program. And at the same time, that gave us really good information about what they thought was happening in the field. So that's been a really good experience, and it helped us to spread the word. We were very active on social media, and we created what I think is a super, we have an excellent graphic designer, a really fun, colorful look for the fellowships program, and I have bookmarks that people are welcome to take if they're interested. And in the same color scheme, a poster that is basically a brochure. So we did all those things, all those outreach efforts. We'll continue to provide a really good experience for the people who do come, because we feel like those are ambassadors and we want them to spread the word. And we want to continue to be smart about the changes that we do make to our collections policy, that we keep that audience in mind. That's all I have. I look forward to your questions. Thank you.
So I run the digitization lab here and work with history science collections pretty closely.
Yep.
So I was wondering, trying to translate my experience and pay attention to what you're talking about for Linda Hall, I was wondering to what extent you emphasize or have goals through digitization of
yep.
your collections.
Yes. So we, and that's the part of the library that's not my part. You know, I think we'll have input, the scholarship side will have input into that side, but the technical services is actually on a different part of the org chart. So we, in the past, are people getting okay audio? It feels a little staticky. In the past, our digitization efforts have been a little mixed. The strategy has been somewhat determined by use. So if we used a book in an exhibition, we would then just digitize the whole book and make it available, and sometimes it lived on as part of a digital exhibit, sometimes not. But we digitize those works. If a scholar requested a digital image of something, again, once it was on the Cradle, the whole thing would be digitized. And then it was made available through Content DM online. So it was this, it was pretty user-driven. I think there are some exceptions to that. There was a grant that we got for doing our railway journals, and so that was a systematic digitization effort where lots of our old railway journals were digitized. And then I think the final kind of strategic piece was, or is, and continues to be the CRL digitization effort. And the Linda Hall Library just renewed its, or is in the process of renewing the CRL agreement. So I think that's been a really positive experience, and I think that's going to go forward into the future. So those have been sort of some of the digitization efforts. We have a new vice president for access and digital services, and the hope is very much that that person will think about, you know, getting grants for particular collections and thinking also about how to manage the stuff that has been digitized, because I think Content DM has gotten somewhat mixed reviews for us. Again, this is outside, it is outside my area of expertise, but that's been some of the thinking behind it. And I think, you know, for the research and scholarship piece, I think the sweet spot really will be for that material to be very usable and smartly digitized, and that will be a complement to people coming in and actually using our paper sources.
I have a couple of questions about CRL.
Yes.
First is that you said you're just now renewing that agreement. Mm-hmm. So how often does that agreement have to be renewed?
So we had a 5-year agreement with them, and those 5 years are up. And my understanding is, I'm not directly involved in that negotiation, but my understanding is that this will be a longer term agreement with CRL.
And Carrie may have shared with you that we have been actively reviewing our serial holdings. We made some decisions regarding JSTOR journals that I feel comfortable about, because JSTOR journals are so, there are multiple print archives for JSTOR journals, but we'll be looking at some other titles that won't necessarily be JSTOR journals. They may be in the West. We have our own agreements that have given us perpetual access, but I'm wondering about, do you regularly have some sort of a memorandum of agreement with the libraries who give materials to you. The reason I ask is, we've always been informed that we need to interpret Oklahoma state laws saying we either have to get rid of materials or we have to give them to another state institution. Now, we're a member of the Western Storage Trust, mm-hmm. and we have agreements with a couple of libraries that actually allow us to give our materials to them. It's like a 25-year loan, but the truth is no one's ever going to, right, to go back, right, and, you know, get a 25 years and say, okay, send them back.
Yes.
So I'm wondering if you have been developing MOUs with institutions who have given you materials they're no longer holding.
So is this agreement or this stipulation that you have, is it a first right of refusal? Or is it absolutely either needs to be recycled or given? It's not a first right of refusal.
It's not a first right.
That's really interesting. So it is my understanding that we have had some arrangements like that where things have been sort of housed with us. We have tried for legal reasons to not have these kind of agreements that are sort of, we're giving them to you, but we're gonna come maybe take them back, except for we all know that we never will. So I think we've tried to shy away from that because we want it to be legally very, very clear. So I would have to, we are always open to talk about taking in materials, assuming it's in scope and it's in good condition. But I would have to defer to my colleagues in terms of exactly what's possible. I do know that the idea is that we get these holdings basically given to us, and we want to have in paper that we now own them and not just house them.
I strongly suspect that anything that we might be considering not retaining is something you already have, but
you never know. And you know, sometimes it's been what's fun, I think, sometimes is that we have really long holdings, except for we'll have a gap. So we've been able to fill gaps from different libraries, and that's really cool. Or we recently got offers of, we're a patent and trademark resource center. So we recently got an offer of the patent gazettes, the 19th century patent gazettes, and our collections people looked and compared and were able to remove some that were not in as good of condition as the ones that we took in. So we're always open to conversations. Our stacks have room, they're in really nice shape, and we'd be excited to fill in gaps as well.
So that does bring up another question, which is government publications. Mm-hmm. Have you collected?
Yes, we have a huge collection of gov docs.
But you're not considered a depository?
I think we are, actually. Yeah.
So I follow some of your digital presence. Mm-hmm. I'm always struck at the public forums and public presentations of the wide array of body that it seems to be just community members that show up for various talks. And so I'm curious if you could address the role of the Linda Hall and its public programming,
yes,
and its relationship to the broader teams.
Yes. So when I talked about the mission statement, one is to be a print preservation place that documents the science, technology, and engineering disciplines. And then the other piece are sort of the two legs. One is the raising public understanding of science. The other one is to be an international destination for research. The piece that I'm focusing on is the international destination for scholarly research. But the goal is, and the other piece, Eric Ward is our vice president for public programs. And he really helps with that piece of raising public understanding of science. What I think we're all interested in doing at the library is to make sure that those pieces talk to each other. So I think the 80-20 Fellowship is actually one way where we bring in a scholar who's doing good work and we communicate to the Kansas City community why it matters, right? And I think especially as the humanities are under threat, it is really on us to communicate to the public what we do. And it's not about watering down our scholarship, it's about explaining well why our scholarship is important. And I think doing targeted things like that helps with that effort. I mean, I think it's also, you know, a development concern. As you look for funding for things like somebody to work on 16th century astronomy, people might think that that's been done. So it is on us to talk about why it needs to be done now and why it needs to be continued to be done. So the scholarly piece and the public piece ideally will really play well together. I think we're very fortunate in that Kansas City, you know, I've lived there for only a little over a year. I've been really impressed with the extent to which Kansas Cityans show up. The public library has a really good public program as well, and they'll get like really kind of wonky, nerdy political talks in, and they'll fill the house. And so I was really struck by the fact that Kansas Cityans, they value their cultural institutions, they're very engaged, and they will come. We'll fill the house. We can get over 300 people to fill our reading room for a given speaker. So I think Eric Ward is very good about thinking of contemporary issues that are of contemporary interest that also really tie in nicely with our rare books and with our exhibits. So he curates the exhibits. They will have some of our books under glass. They will have interpretive panels, and then he'll get speakers in who are just totally fabulous and fun. That people will be interested in seeing. So I think those things all go together. They can all support each other. And I think we're very lucky. I think Kansas Cityans are very receptive to that. So we have a really kind of good, loyal following, and we can get other people to show up as well.
Yeah. I was interested in your users. So you always thought that the History of Science collection, they're probably attracting people in the field. You're saying you're trying to make that more well-known and broader. Mm-hmm. What about science policy or contemporary issues? Are people coming? Was that an area that you talked about or thought about?
So we talk about it. We'll have, like, this isn't exactly science policy, but we'll have, like, patent lawyers. We'll use the collections. Or people who are looking for historical information. A lot of times our standards get used by people doing like civil engineering or these kinds of people who want to use contemporary collections like that. We have not done anything explicitly for the fellowships to get people in policy, although I think it's a cool idea. I really like it. I think the challenge a little bit is to make the argument that they can't get everything digitally, right? There the challenge is to say, you know what, we have these amazing sources, you need these paper sources for policy. I'm sure it can be done. I think some of our public programming can also underscore the relevance. For example, we had Lisa Brower, the president of the library, hosted a second, we have second Saturday programs, and she hosted a panel of speakers in science, technology, engineering, and policy to talk about basically what's the outlook in 2017. It was basically a panel discussion on, with the new administration, what is the outlook for science, technology, and policy in the environment. So I think we can do more of that. I think some of our public programs do some of that, but I think in terms of the fellowships, we could be more active in that way. And if you have ideas, I would actually love to hear them as well. Yeah.
Just a question about sort of the physicality of being devoted to paper.
Yeah.
You said you know, wanted to do paper. Is paper mean paper, or does paper mean physical? And how does microfilm or microfiche fit into that? Because doing visual studies for anything, you know, a lot of places will digitize things that already exist in microfilm. But when you get it, you can't see the image.
Yes.
Because it's hard black and white.
So we have microfilm and microfiche, but we prefer the paper. So sometimes we're offered those formats, and in some cases I think we take them, but our preference really is to get the paper piece. Yes, the physical paper. As you so eloquently put it.
If this blob is a rock or a mammoth.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. And you know, I have to say one of the funnest things for me is we had somebody last year, some of you know actually, we had a fellow last year who worked on Copernicus and was with us for 6 months. And what I thought was the coolest thing was to see him with one of our 16th century books in the cradle. He had his laptop open to the copy that's in the State Library in Munich, and he had his desktop doing something else. So to me, we need to make the case, not just about the fact that advanced scholarship matters, but also that it matters to have paper, right? And I think that it's not obvious. Like, if it's digitally accessible, great. Why would you need the paper? But I think working closely with our fellows who are in-house and having them articulate why it's worth their while to come from all over the world to Kansas City to turn the pages of our books is really important. And so for me, that's it, right? It's not that we're Luddites. It's not that we don't like technology. It's just that we think paper is a pretty amazing technology as well that can supplement other technologies in meaningful and useful ways.
How do you grow your audience by reaching out to secondary or elementary schools?
Our audience primarily is adult learners in terms of our public audience. We do some supportive stuff for STEM. For example, we got a grant from the Kauffman Foundation, and that grant is about, or part of that grant is to help high school students with STEM education. So we have made an effort, I'm just supporting that. This is not primarily under me at all. But there's been an effort in-house to reach out to high school teachers and to make them aware of our public programs. We had Lori Baker, who's a forensic anthropologist, come a couple weeks ago. It was unbelievable. And then we have a second Saturday program specifically for high school students called How Do I Become a Forensic Scientist? So we'll do things like that. There are also, we also do rare book presentation. So we have high school classes and we have area college classes come in, various other groups as well. But we talk to them about the history of science and the works that we have. And we can be pretty targeted depending on what they need. So we can talk about specific content areas. If they're doing a history biology class, we will tailor the presentation to that, and we can also be somewhat kind of conceptually specific. If they're interested in the history of scientific publication, we can show them the Philosophical Transactions of the Royal Society, the first volume from 1665, and talk about the fact that we're still subscribed to this journal. So we do stuff like that. Primarily, though, our audience is adult learners. I think I've exhausted everyone.
That's all. Tania, thank you for coming.